Yeah, so in principle, we should now look on representations of the CCR and see whether they have a vacuum in their representation. Yeah, but the problem with dealing with these operators P and Q or A and A star is that they are unbounded and there are issues with the domain, and it's not so easy to deal with this, and actually there are also pathological examples, and it's, yeah, so what we really will do is to rewrite the situation from the P and Q to the unitary groups which they generate, by the theorem of Stone, or this idea, we know that we can exponentiate those guys, and then we get operators which are bounded operators, unitary operators which are defined everywhere, and we can deal much easier with those. So the idea is that instead of looking on the original formulation of the CCR, we rewrite this in another way, which maybe is also from a physical point of view also quite meaningful, because the time evolution operators are maybe the very, very canonical operators, and we just look in terms of those, avoiding the problems with the unbounded domains. So let us see what we get if we do this rewriting, let's say in the Schrödinger equation. I mean, we could do it formally on the level of general P and Q, which just satisfy those relations, or maybe we just do it directly in the Schrödinger representation and see what relation we have there between the two unitary groups which are given by our two operators. Okay, so we rewrite the CCR relations in terms of the unitary groups which are generated by P and Q. Okay, so let us look on this in a Schrödinger representation. Schrödinger representation as we just did. So this was just the example before. So just let me recall the Q of F. So our Hilbert space is the L2 of R. We had a nice dense domain by functions of rapid decay, and there the Q is given by multiplying the function with an argument x, and the p is given by taking the derivative and multiplying it with 1 over i, 1 over i times the derivative of x. Okay, so usually I use t as an argument if I have functions on L2 of r, but now if I have my unitary groups, t will also be an argument for the unitary group, so I prefer here to use x as the argument for functions on L2 of r. Okay, so q is just multiplication with the argument, and p is, up to this factor, the derivative. And we know those are self-adjoint operators, or the closure of those are self-adjoint operators, and so we can take the exponential functions of them, and they generate, each of them generates a strongly continuous unitary group. So we take both of them, so we consider the corresponding unitary groups, and the one for P, let me call this UT, so for each T, this is e to the I T P, and for Q, I'm going to call it VT. So this is for each T, e to the I T Q. Yeah, and we know that the UT contains all the information about the P, and the VT contains all the information about the Q. The Q is a generator of this, and the P is a generator of this group. So one can go in both directions. Yeah, so we have this, and maybe let us now think or write down how those guys act concretely in this representation. So those act as... So first of all, the UT, so the UT on a function f at, let's say, position x, what is this? So this is something which we did in exercise. So the derivative operator generates as a unitary group just the translation. So this is essentially Taylor's formula, which tells us that this ut for the derivative operator is just my function shifted by the amount t. So t is the t here. So x is the argument of my function. So this is a function here, but then I'm shifting it by t. Yeah, and for v, I mean v, so q is just a multiplication operator. So if I take a function of q, this is just a multiplication with this function. So this means vt is also very easy to write down in this case. So vt of f at the argument x, this is just multiplying the function with e to the I t x times my function. So q is just multiplication with x, so e to the I t q, or maybe more general, a function of q is just multiplication with this function in x. Okay, so here I just multiply with this. Yeah, and now I can look on the relation between those two groups. So each of them, of course, is very nicely well-defined and contains all the information about the P or about the Q. And now the relation between P and Q should now be encoded somehow in the relation between those two guys. So let us look on the commutator between this. So let's see, what do I get if I apply a V and a U, but in different orders? So what we have here, let me maybe first take, so I'm taking a ut and I'm taking a vs for arbitrary t and s, and I'm multiplying them in both orders. So let us first take ut vs. If I apply this to f, so I should get a function in the end, a function of x. And what is this? So this is u applied to this function vs of v. So I take vs of f, and I apply to this function, I apply ut, but ut, I mean, shifts the argument by t. So what I get is this function, where the argument is shifted by t, and this function here, what does it on f? It just multiplies it with e to the it, and then the argument, but the argument is here x plus t. So what I get here is, yeah, maybe write it here. So this is e to the I, and actually I take now the s, because I have the vs here. So this t here is an s, so I'm multiplying with e s x. No, I'm multiplying, okay, doing it again. So I take, I take I, then I take the s, which is the t here, and then I have here the argument, but the argument now is x plus t. So x plus t. And then I still have the function at this argument, x plus t. So what is the effect of ut times vs on my function? This is multiplying the function with this factor here, which contains s and t, and doing a shift by t. Yeah, and now let us compare this with doing it the other way around. So let us also look what I get if I take vs times ut. So vs times ut, applying this to a function f and taking it at the argument x. Yeah, so now I apply vs to this function, and doing it at this argument, and vs, what does it do? It multiplies the function with e to the I, and again, I have an s here, and now I take the argument, but the argument is now x, so I'm multiplying it with e I s x, and then I still have the function ut f at the argument x. So I apply, so I have the function, this function here. To this I apply vs, and this means I'm multiplying it with this factor here, and I take my function at the argument x, and now this function is actually ut applied to f, which means I have to shift the argument. So this here is f of x plus t. So what I get here is e to the I s x times f of x plus t. Yeah, and so you see the result in both cases is not so far apart. In particular, I get the same shift in my function, but the factor with which I multiply is different. Huh? So I sx appears here, but here I have in addition I st. Huh? And this is the general result which I get here. So namely, the relation between ut and vs and the product in the other order is just a factor e to the I st. And this factor does not depend on x. So this is just a constant, this e to the I st. So this on the other side I have the vs and the ut. Yeah, and so this is now the version of the CCR if I express it in terms of the unitary groups. And that is now really what we take as our starting point for doing the real analysis. So namely, those are the relations for which we want to find representations. And those relations are called Weyl relations. So the Weyl relations are rewritings of the CCR for the unitary groups, and this has the advantage that now we are dealing with bounded operators. We don't have to bother about domains and those things, and we are just asking what can we say about representations of this. And of course we want irreducible representations, and we want them up to unitary equivalence. And maybe now I define all those notions rigorously on this level. I mean, before I talked about unitary equivalent and, of course, irreducible, but I didn't really make it very precise what I mean with this in the context of unbounded operators, because then I have to think about the domain. But now it's very clear what all this means, and now maybe now I'm writing down all those things. So let me give the definition of the Weyl relation. I mean, essentially it is this here, but let me write it down again in a more precise way. So the Weyl relations consist of such a pair ut and vs, where s and t are just running through the real numbers. So, and each of them are strongly continuous unitary groups, so of strongly continuous unitary groups. So each of them is such a strongly continuous unitary group. So one of them is ut, which is indexed by t, and the other is vs, indexed by s. But both are just real numbers. And of course, they live on the same Hilbert space. If I want to talk about commutation relations, they should be defined on the same object. So if I'm talking about this, I always mean that they live on the same Hilbert space, so they are bounded operators or unitary operators on the same Hilbert space, which as usual I denote by H, Hilbert space H, so if I ever need it. So I say such a pair is a representation of the Weyl relations. Is a representation of the Weyl relations, so after Hermann Weyl, if we have exactly the relations as written above. So if we have that ut times us is e to the ITS VS ut, and this should be true for all s and t in R. So I mean, t and s can be the same, and still, I mean, even if t is equal to s, they don't commute, but they still have a factor here, or they can be different. So for all s and t, I want to have the relation like this. And of course, I mean, u of t has a generator. Something is wrong here, so I should have one V on this side. So this here is the V. I'm multiplying U with V, and I connect this with V multiplied with U. And the V has the index S here, and the U has the index T. So it's really the UT appears also here on the side, and the VS is the same on both sides. And of course, I mean, the U has a generator, which we might then call P, and the V has a generator, which we might call Q, and then one can think about what one can say about them, and of course they will then satisfy in a very nice way the CCR relations. Yeah, but our requirements are on this level. Good, okay, and so maybe, as I said, we are interested in such representations, but mainly in irreducible ones, because if I have a representation, I can build new ones by taking direct sums. And I want to have the smallest components in such direct sum decompositions, and those are the irreducible ones. So maybe let me now also write down exactly what I mean with the irreducibility of such a representation. So this representation is irreducible. Irreducible. If there is no non-trivial Hilbert space, sub-Hilbert space of my big Hilbert space, which is invariant under the action of both of them. So if there is no sub-Hilbert space of my Hilbert space H, where everything is defined, so there is no sub-Hilbert space, maybe let me call it K, the guy which does not exist is called K, so this should be a sub-Hilbert space of H, and this should be non-trivial, and this means it's not, I mean the trivial sub-Hilbert spaces are the smallest possible sub-Hilbert space, which consists just of zero, and it's the whole space. So those two sub-Hilbert spaces, of course, are trivially invariant under the action of all U's and all V's. So this is not what I want, but I want to see that whether there is another one or not. So this non-trivial means that K is not just consisting of zero, and it's not just the whole Hilbert space. But the question is there an intermediate one for which the action of U and the action of V just maps this guy to itself. So such that U of T applied to K is a subset of K, and the action of V of S on K is also landing in K. And this should be true for all S and for all T. So all U's should map K to K, and all V's should map K to K. So K should be invariant under the action of all U's and the action of all V's. Okay, and so if I have such a thing, then I would have a reducible representation, and irreducible means that I can exclude this. So there should not exist such a K. And maybe, let me also write down maybe the last part, namely the unitarily equivalence. So of course we want to see what are the irreducible representations of the Weyl relations, and of course we want to see this up to unitary equivalence. Of course, I mean if I change the basis in my Hilbert space, then of course I get another representation, but of course this is equivalent to the first one. So those I'm not going to distinguish. And so this is made precise in the next part. So we say that two such representations are unitarily equivalent if we have such a unitary which intertwines everything. So two such representations. Two representations. Let's say one representation consists of U's and V's, UT and VS, and the other one consists of guys which I denote by a prime. So it consists of UT prime and VS prime, and of course they might live on different Hilbert spaces a priori. So let's say those two guys live on Hilbert space H, and those live on a Hilbert space H prime. Okay, so I assume I have two such representations of the while relations. And then I say they are unitarily equivalent. So are unitarily equivalent. That's what I'm defining here. If I find a unitary from one Hilbert space to the other, which maps everything into each other, all the quantities on H are mapped to the corresponding quantities on H prime. So if there is a unitary operator. Usually I denote unitary operators by U. Okay, but U is already used, so maybe let me denote it by W. And this should be now a mapping from H to H prime. I mean, we have here mappings not from a Hilbert space to itself, but between different Hilbert spaces, but a unitary operator is just a bijective mapping which maps an orthonormal basis here to an orthonormal basis here. So it's just a change of the coordinate system. It can also be a mapping from H to itself, where it really is just a change of the coordinate system. If I go from here to here, I'm just identifying an orthonormal basis here with an orthonormal basis here, and then I can rewrite everything what I had here into a new quantities here. And so I want here that I have such a unitary operator which maps the U to the U prime and the V to the V prime. So if I have such a unitary such that the UT in the new coordinate system is the W star UT prime W and the VS is the VS prime conjugated with the W. And this should be true for all S and T in R. Or maybe as a picture, which maybe even makes it even clearer. I have the U's and the V's, which are operators on H. So the UT and the VS, they go from H to H. And then I have the primed quantities, which live on the Hilbert space H prime. So the UT prime and the VS prime, they map H prime to H prime. And now I say this situation here is essentially the same as the situation here, because I have a unitary mapping W, which maps from here to here, and of course the W star goes back, and this connects all these quantities. So this means the UT, which goes from here to here, is the same as if I first go here, then apply the UT prime, and then going back again, and for the V the same. So this is just the usual unitary equivalence, which says that, this might look different, but it's the same up to this change of the coordinate system. So unitarily equivalent representations we are not going to distinguish. So our question will be whether every irreducible representation of the Y relations is unitarily equivalent to the Schrödinger representation. And of course, if I'm saying it like this, I'm already implying that the Schrödinger representation is irreducible. So maybe that's something which we also should first think about before we address this general question.